Yeah. All right.
No, I mean, like, you had to be busier now. Are you busier now with podcasts and things? But podcasts and things, not with comedy.
Podcast. Yeah, podcast, definitely. Well,
you're taking advantage of it.
I got to talk to you about what we're doing in Atlantic City. Yeah. We're starting shows.
You're starting comedy?
Yes, we did. They did one Saturday. I'm on this Saturday. I already got news people doing story. I got Channel 10 News here, NBC. My friend is on there. And then I hit up Norton. I'm still waiting for him.
Because what's the capacity? How many people are they letting in? Like 25%, 35%?
In the parking lots.
Oh, like a drive-in, but with you guys.
Yeah.
That's – I think if there's any comic that can handle that, it's you.
Yeah, they did it, but it works. I seen them do it. It works. The people beep the horns and when they like a joke.
Right.
It works. It's better.
No, but it works for someone of your style. If you tried to put like a one-liner guy or one of those like nerdy woke comics, they couldn't handle that. You like – rowdy, you like raucous, that would be good for you. You know what I mean? Yeah, the beeping and the yelling and all that.
I mean, I do pretty quick. I'm pretty one-liner-ish, but I know what to do. You know what I mean? I seen what they did, so it's cool.
You enjoy animals because that's who your audience is, and so that's who would go. Someone in a car beeping and I mean, in a good sense, but that's the kind of person that would go. The person that wants to go see like Mike Kaplan or something is not going to go in their car and beep as he does wordplay. You know what I mean? Like, it's not going to happen that way.
No, but they're just happy to be out to people, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I think so. I think people are going to be happy to be out. I think the majority of people want to be out, but there's going to be that new group. The ones that were yelling about woke comics before, now their new thing to yell about is, why are you out? What are you doing? And they're going to be the vocal minority that tries to shut all our fun down.
Yeah, but as long as you get the okay by the state and all that, you're set.
Right. Oh, no, you're set with the state. I'm just talking about the stupid social media world where they can just keep putting a buzz on and can't say anything. And all of a sudden, Bob Levy's trying to kill people with coronavirus by having a good time. It's like, if we can learn anything from this, why can't people learn to mind their own fucking business, take care of themselves, and let other people do what we do? We only have so much time in our lives. You and I want to make people laugh. Let us make people laugh that want to have laughs. If you don't want laughs, stay the fuck home.
They ain't going to do that. There's no way they're going to. People have to complain. They have to complain whether they like it or they don't like it. They're just fucking, everybody has a fucking opinion now, and their opinions suck. It doesn't, you know, you don't have an opinion on somebody's life, what they want to do. And just shut the fuck up. If you don't want to do it, stay home. You know, what's so hard about that? You know, everybody wants to go out and just go. They used to go to stores, and you see people complaining the line's too long and that shit. You're not, and then they turn to me, and I'm like, you're not getting me into your game of misery. I'm not playing that fucking game. You're not doing it.
I don't mind if people complain. But if you're going to complain, then have a solution. If you're going to tell me I can't do something, then if you're going to open your mouth, have a solution what you think I should do. Like, if someone starts yelling all the time that there shouldn't be abortions, I'm like, great, then you keep this baby. When the baby comes out, you have it. If not, shut the fuck up. Have a reason for me to do it. Have a way I can do comedy. And don't tell me Zoom comedy because it's not the same. We all need the energy from each other. It's one of the greatest feelings, not just for us on stage, but if you watch the people in the audience, when they're laughing, that's a laugh you don't get by staring at a computer screen. It's a real moment that we all share together that people need again. We're losing that touch.
Yeah, when you see tears coming out of somebody's eyes at a comedy show, you're like fucking – you know, you have to stop and say something because it's the greatest fucking feeling in the world. I mean, I've been married 4 times. I know how to make women cry. But to do this is fucking amazing. Like when you're on stage, you know, and it's like, you know, we've been off so long. It's like I haven't really even thought about what I do. You know what I mean? And the whole time, because when it's time, it's just going to come. And if I do screw up, it's going to be funny because I'm going to take it that way, too. Like we're all rusty. Even the audience is rusty.
Oh yeah. I mean, it's gonna be tough. Like the last time I performed was March 14th. I remember the day because it was a great show. It was in Upper State, New York. It was almost in Canada and everything went the way it was supposed to. So in a way I'm lucky and thankful because my last memory is a good one where made me love comedy. I know some people whose last gig that they bombed or was no one showed up or was terrible. And then they have that taste in their mouth. Where like, I can't get rid of it. We always need that next day when you're a relief pitcher, you need that next day. If you have a homer, you need to come back in. And we need that. And with that, with this lull of now over 2 months I haven't performed, thank God I have a nice memory at least.
Yeah, when you, it's like when you fucking fat chick, your thing is, I have to get out tomorrow. I got to do better. You know what I mean? I don't know what happened. You know, I was meted, drank a little too much. I might have been a little tired. My eyes were fucked up.
Maybe she fell on me. I don't know what happened. Yeah, but like,
I was trapped.
I was going to eat my way out, but she took it the wrong way. It's like, that can happen. You're right. But then the next day, I'm not – believe me, the next day, the girl doesn't have to be thin. She just has to be lighter than the last one. That's all it is. You don't have to go to a perfection. You don't have to kill the next day. You have to just get a little bit better. She has to be under 400 this time. That's all you ask.
That's it. You know what I mean? Just a little bit and we feel good. You know what I mean? A little extra makeup and fucking stand on an angle.
That's it. But I don't know if she could. I mean, to be clear, if she could stand on an angle that worked, she'd be standing on that angle. She'd be set up like a little ballerina in a jewelry box all the time if she could get the right angle. There is no angle in your globe.
Yeah, when in the morning is the worst thing, when you hear her leaving a house and you hear her hitting the hallways, walls as she's walking out, you're like, fuck.
You hear it and you're like, wait, am I in National Geographic? I think there's a herd coming. And then Greenpeace shows up and shoots her to put her back into the bed. She falls on your arm and you have to gnaw your way out like 128 hours just to escape from the monster. But it's better than being alone, I guess.
Yeah, you know what? It's the same thing as being home. Like, I mean, it's really mentally, you know, I have days that are really bad. You know what I mean?
Same here,
and the pain, I still couldn't get my operation because I got canceled the week before for my neck surgery because of the COVID. And now, you know, I have to deal with pain, like really ridiculous today through my spine and my right side lower back is killing me. And it's like, you know, there's nothing we can do right now, you know, but it's like, you can't, you know, to go out to a store and wear a mask, I can't breathe with anything on my face or my head. I get claustrophobic. Right. And to see people wearing it, I feel like I'm in a fucking Twilight Zone episode and I really can't handle it. So I really don't go out much except in the backyard.
It is weird. Like I'm used to people wearing masks and I have caught myself now once or twice seeing someone without one and going, what? Is everything okay? Like, I only wear it when someone makes me. Like, I lost, like everyone else, I lost all my gigs. I'm a guy who's been opening for bigger names or headlining very small places. I didn't have any savings. I'm a divorced guy. The second all my gigs went away, I had nothing. I had to go take a retail job and work in a store now in the morning, like 25 hours. I haven't worked for somebody in 10 years. So it's weird to have a boss, but even weirder, they'll tell me you have to wear a mask in there. If they tell me I have to, I will. But if I can go anywhere without it, the second I leave the store, the mask comes off. I'm not wearing it unless someone makes me do it by their rules in their place. I respect that. That's their place. That's their business. If they want me to wear a mask inside at a grocery store or whatever, I'll do it. But the second you tell me I don't have to, I will not.
Yeah. See, here we have to wear a mask if we go to a place, any place that's open. We have to wear a mask. Even on the beach, they want you to wear a mask. Who's going to get a tan like this with a mask on? You know what I mean? But like, as soon as I get out of the store, I have to pull it off because I can't handle it. But we have to wear it everywhere in Jersey. And it doesn't look, those things don't really stop things from, you know, I don't get it.
It's not going to. Listen, it didn't stop. The Chinese wore them all the time, and the guy still ate a bat. He took it off to do that. So it's like they're not stopping anything. But you know what, though? That'd be cool if the new tan line was goggles on your eyes and then the mask on your face, and you showed it, and it looked like a bikini on your dumb head. That'd be nice. I'd watch that porn.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be. It's going to be, you know, mask sex and shit like that and pornos and that. And it's just like, this ain't the new norm. Everyone's saying it's the new normal. No, it's not the fucking new normal. I can't deal with this shit. I mean, if you're outside, hey, look, if everybody can stay at home and stay away from each other, social distance, you can do it at work. You can open up every business and put in 25% of workers first, test them as they're going in and out, and just go from there. And everything opens up like that. And everything, it's not going to change anything because everybody, you know, when you go to a fucking supermarket, the places are packed and you come home with fucking chicken pot pie because there's nothing left. Right. So you went out for chicken pot pie and now you got the corona. Fuck you.
Yeah. Is anything the new normal when you're calling it a thing? No, I never called normal normal. You know what I mean? It was just normal. You don't call it that. It's insane to give it a title. We're never going to go back to what we were, but because there's going to be too many morons scared, whatever. And young kids who are going through this right now, this is going to trigger them. They're going to have weird therapy. They're going to be afraid to go into groups. There's going to be a group of people growing up now, like 5 to 12, that's going to be afraid to go into crowds, into stores, because this is traumatic, I would guess, if you're a kid. You don't know what a germ is. You don't understand. You're just told now you can't go in front of people. You can't go see people. You're going to be afraid of your grandparents that didn't die because they're going to be told, don't see grandma. It could kill her.
Well, you know what happens when, okay, say they die some other reason, right? And you just happen to hug them or something like that. You're, as a kid, you're going to think, I killed grandma. You know, right. That's the whole thing that's going to be mentally in their heads.
And you're like, that was just my birthday wish. I didn't know I could do it.
It's yeah.
Like, who, I mean, if I knew that, I would have hugged my third grade teacher a long time ago. It's like,
well, that's what it is. I mean, everyone's going to be hugging their ex-wives now when it comes to that.
Let me just hold you a little longer. Thanks for the memory. You got a lot of hugs to give out, I guess. <It's> like, if you had a business right now, besides comedy, if you owned a comedy club, anything non-essential, a store, whatever, what would you do right now? Would you say, fuck you, I'm doing it, and arrest me? Would you say, I'm listening to you? Or what would you do right now?
Well, look, I mean, my idea was to get my operation, get settled, right? And then open up a club or open up, you know, a whole thing with 4 people on 4 different tours and promote it and do everything. And, you know, so I can get good people working and know it's a great show. But if I just opened up a comedy club, I would lose everything I put into it. There's no doubt about it. So there would have to be something I would have to do. I'd have to think about it, but I would open it up somehow and use like the parking lot, like they're doing at AC Jokes, you know, in Atlantic City, because you have to have something coming in, especially if you're still paying the mortgage, you know? You have to. You know,
if I was a comedy club right now, I would open up my kitchen, if I had one, and I would just serve food out of it. Because if they're taking care of everyone else with the, hey, go get your takeout. If you're going to get takeout from a steakhouse, which is weird, because you're supposed to eat a steak in a steakhouse. You're supposed to bring that home. That's weird. But if you're going to do that, have comedy clubs do it. I would have people in there making wings, doing whatever. And then that way, every time they take their food, have a lineup for like a coupon for like the next time we open up, free show on a way to remind people we're here. Something of that nature to let them know. Because I think it's so funny that all the, like, everyone in the world, radio stations, everyone has taken on the role of, we need to support the nurses and we need to support the restaurants. But the people that go on all the radio stations are entertainers like us, but they're not like, hey, go support your local comic. They lost all their money. We're going on their shows for free all the time. And all of a sudden we can't go on because they're trying to be serious and not fart jokes. It's become a very weird thing what they're angling to do. Yeah. And I've argued about other things. I get it. Nurses are doing a good job, but why aren't we clapping for the doctors? They're the fucking headliner. The nurse is the opening act. They're not, let them dance around. They're the real one. Why don't people support us? If I had a comedy club, I'd remind people, hey, every time you buy wings, $1 is going to go to trying to help the comics out or something dumb like that. They're the ones who made you laugh. They can't work anymore. You know,
we all got destroyed. Yeah, and to get unemployment seems like the hardest thing. Like, I'm still waiting, you know what I mean? And it's been since, you know, March. And it being self-employed, it makes it harder, they say. It takes longer. But it's been waiting to go through. It's pending.
I filled out unemployment, and I got back. I didn't get anything for the comedy. I got stuff for my part-time radio gig. Part-time. Okay. I worked 5 hours, 6 hours a week. That's it. That's what I'm getting unemployment money off of right now, which is absolutely nothing. I've messaged and said, hey, what about the other part there? And the same thing as you're saying. They're waiting. They're saying they have ways of doing it, but they're figuring it out. Like most comics, I didn't fill out my taxes for 2019 yet because we all pay taxes. I don't think people realize that. We don't get money taken out. We have to pay our taxes. So I was waiting to do it. So they said, wait till June. I was going to wait till June now. I've got my 2018s already. I can show you that, but I don't have my 2019s because why would I do that yet? I need more gigs. I need a good weekend to pay off the taxes for the year.
No, it's like, and especially they're supposed to give you 600. You got to say it's due to the coronavirus. Right. So you get 600 unemployment right off the bat. Even if you got 300, you basically make about 900 a week to survive, which is possible, you know what I mean? But right now, it's not possible. I mean, since the car accident and this, I mean, I really couldn't get going. This has been going on 3 years now. So now it's like I'm sitting there going, okay, I have to get one more heart test that I have to pay cash for, okay? And then I have to get the blood work done for the final thing before the operation. It has to be 30 days out. And I'm hoping in June, you know what I mean? Once they tell me I can get the blood work, then in June, but like I have enough money to get the test done for the heart. And I have a little money to maybe go shopping one more time, right. But that's it. You know what I mean? And it's like, fuck it, man. You know, it's like, I feel like I'm on the Titanic, but it's okay because I know things work out all the time. I always used to worry about shit, but something will happen that'll turn shit around, you know, within the time when I'm fucking like ready to fucking, right. You know, I got the knife to my neck.
Yeah, it does always seem like that someone does come and grab that arm and go, not yet, dude. I mean, yeah, you could do it, but do it in front of people at least. Make some money off it, you know? No, same here. I've struggled through a lot in my life, but every time I thought it was going to be its worst, something happened somewhere, and I'm the same way. I'm not worried, but this one's getting weird because sometimes things happen out of your control, but nothing's ever happened where I had no control. There was ways I'd have to like swallow my pride or whatever, do this and that, and I could fix things. But with this, it's like, what do you do? And like people, I hate to compare it to it, but 9/11, people had compassion. Coronavirus, no one has compassion. You can talk to your bill collectors and your landlords and all that stuff all you want. For a minute, they'll go, yeah, I get it. But they're also suffering. So they're like, yeah, I'm not making money either. You might not want to pay your rent this month, but I can't pay the mortgage off the place you rent unless you pay me rent. So they're not going to be understanding. Now, I know they might put some bills in there, but they haven't done that yet. That should have been the first thing. Even before Trump sent us money, the first thing should have been renters, mortgages. Oh, I hate to say it. It would have hurt some people, but you all get a month off. That would have been easier than the $1,200.
Well, that's what it is. Like my mortgage company is allowing whatever. You know what I mean? They said, we'll just put it on the back end. So now
they're not allowing it. They're just saying pay it later. And all of a sudden, when we get back to work, it's not going to be like it's great what you guys said are doing an AC, but like for the most part, the work's going to be way less. If I'm a comedy club, I know I'm not getting hired right away because I'm not a name that can draw. They got to make some money. I'm the guy you hire, you know, a headline during the summer, a headline smaller places and stuff, and get to open for people. But right now, I mean, there's. The local opener is done because once this starts again, a headliner is going to come in. If he has an agent or management, whatever, they're going to also try to get their other clients in to open for them. Why not? They got to get them all work. Someone like me is screwed. I won't be able to pay back ends of anything. The second we open up, I won't open up for a while.
Yeah. And the only way to make it fair, truthfully, for the bookers, club owners, and comics is basically the way we looked at it was you have to do 3 shows. To get the money that you can with the 30% of the audience allowed in. So you have to like 25%, even 25%, you figure it goes to 75% with the 3 shows and you have to say, well, 25 because it wasn't going to sell out probably anyway, right. You know, with a regular one. So that's the only way to kind of be fair. But you figure every comedian that got canceled, right, is on the back end of everyone that's booked right now. So we're looking into March at least before you start getting in club. And you think Florida is going to fly somebody out to go do a gig in Florida?
The people that are working Florida gigs, I know the guys who do those. Those clubs are cool. I've never worked them. I know guys who do them. Those clubs will bring in people and do things, but they're not flying you in. They're bringing you in because they pay for a cheaper rate. It's a cheaper thing, but you're getting work. All these gigs are going to be cheaper pay, and it's going to be people that want to do it. When this first started, I thought, oh, someone like me might help work out because the bigger names will be like, well, I'm not traveling yet. I'm afraid to. I don't need to. So I figured I'd be able to come in. Now, the longer it's gone, they're getting that itch. They want to be out there, and I think a lot of people are going to take the chances now. I'm seeing guys like, you know, compound type people like Landau and Berg and stuff like that. They're getting booked now, getting ready to go out. You know, Tim Dillon, they're all getting dates and things. So if they're already taking those dates and going
it's going to be crazy.
But now they're letting them go and do it. They had them, but they moved things around. You know what I mean? They're able to take them. I thought those kind of people would say, I'm staying home. So they'd have to call the relief pitcher like me to come in and go, he doesn't care if he dies. He'll come on out.
Yeah, I mean, it is crazy if you really think about it. But we're like way away from this being normal in comedy again, because you figure people will be afraid to go out, which is fine. But, you know, once they allow a full room, we got to think, when is that going to be? Yeah. And until then, we're the ones that are going to take it in the ass more, like always, because of the fact the club is going to say, oh, we're losing money. And you can't, like, I've noticed, I don't think I've ever won many arguments with clubs, you know, because they can just say, hey, we're low on tickets. We're going to cut your money. What I do is I say, all right, but if it fills up, I get this on the back end.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's the only way to deal with it, because they don't even want to do that because, you know, they don't want it to be full because they have to give out more money. You know what I mean? Right. In their mind.
Well, like, when I was running a club, and this is why I didn't run it for long, that was the one thing I did do. Is like I made sure I said, the club held me to a very low standard of money and things like that. So I always offered bonuses. I said, if you guys can get out there and push it, I'll make sure you get more. And the owners of the club were like, oh, yeah, fine. We don't advertise, so they won't be able to do it. And then some people had a great ability to, like, draw and do stuff. So then the owners were like, okay, stop doing that. They're actually getting money. And I was like, they're making you money. What are you worried about? But now the change is going to be, even if I gave you that bonus, I don't think they'll offer the bonus because are they going to be allowed to serve food and booze? You have to wear masks. You're wearing a mask. How do you take the mask off to eat and drink? So if you're going to – are you going to have – remember like the old smoking, not smoking section? Are you going to have eating, not eating, mask, no mask sections? There's going to be a glass, plexiglass, maybe like a hockey plexiglass in the middle where if that's you want to breathe, be over here and not over there. What are they going to do? Because if not, they're going to make all their money off the booze and the food. Most of these clubs are papered on Thursday nights. They're not all selling tickets. They act like they do. But they're selling on Saturday nights. But Thursday, they're giving out tickets. You're inside a casino. They're handing out tickets. If they hand you out a free ticket and you don't pay any money for a drink, what's the point of having you in there?
Well, so that's how are what they going to do it? Yeah. I mean, you're not going to, you know, somebody's going to complain their mask is off and that shit. That's just a whole new game that I never even thought of.
Try telling your jokes. Most are – you're like me. I know. I've watched your act. We have a ton of facial expressions. You put a mask on my face, that's lose half my jokes.
Well, that's what it is. It's like we couldn't wear a mask. I mean, it's just stupid. I couldn't talk with a fucking mask on and do this. I couldn't do it. I mentally could not fucking do it. Basically, I wouldn't want to do it. You know what I mean? It's right. Like, what the fuck is going on? It's like, you know, I don't want to do it online. I was asked to do it online. And I'm like, it just doesn't, you know what I mean? It's like, don't give people more of a reason to want to stay home, you know?
I get the comics and the clubs and the bookers that are trying to do that. And some comics have told me, no, Pat, it's great. They turn on, you know Mike Keegan?
Yeah.
Yeah, Mike was just, I just had him on and he was telling me that, you know, he goes, it actually wasn't bad. They unmute the Zoom thing and you could actually hear the laughs. And after a couple minutes, it feels normal. I'm like, I need the human interaction. I don't want to do comedy in my, I'll like podcasting in this room.
Yeah.
I don't want to stand here and do comedy. I love being on a stage. That's the whole point. I'm more comfortable as a human on stage than I am off. I want to be on stage when I'm performing. I don't want that. I want to feel that even if I piss them off, I want the groans in my face. I want to feel them mad and happy and sad and disappointed. Like my parents all right there. I want to feel that. I can't feel that through the computer. And they're also, they can ignore me. They can stare at their phone. I can't see.
Exactly. But like he said, it's not bad. That's not what you want to hear when you're doing anything.
Right.
It's not bad. I mean, come on, man. You're basically saying, well, it's not good, but it's not bad.
It's not bad. It's not the worst. Well, I'm not looking for, I mean, I've done gigs where you've said it's not bad and five guys would go, who books that? But it's still, I couldn't do it. I need that feeling of the people there. I need to be honest. I miss that, and if I can't do that, I don't want to do it. Now, I've had someone hit me up and ask me if I would do a underground, I mean, I'm not saying names or whatever, but I've been hit up on underground, like speakeasy, maybe 15 to 20 people in the back. We're like, you know, if the cops came, we could get in trouble, and I kind of like the feel of that, like that renegade thing, but at the same time, the money's going to be donations, and who's going to donate? No one carries cash anymore. You're not going to use your Venmo. You'll get traced to it. So it's like, how are we going to make any money? And it's going to be awful. Like, I don't know my act at all. And I don't, you know what, to be honest with you, I don't want to go back up with my old act. We're such different people now. When I do go back up, I want to start working out. I had just recorded something, so I was going to start working out new stuff anyway, but I want to do a whole new hour.
That's what it is. It's in your mind. I mean, I have a whole book of stuff I'm just going to put in. And then I have, like, everything in my mind now. I like to just do it like that in my mind. Yeah. Just go up there and see where we're going with it. And then exactly. You realize how it's good.
I call it the Peyton Manning, because you call audibles the entire time. I go up there. Yeah. I know what the first joke's going to be. Yeah. And then I read how the crowd's feeling. More importantly, how I'm feeling. Do I need this one to start momentum right now? Or can I start hot with this? Do I have a new idea? Because I love starting off with new ideas. I'll read the room, read myself, more importantly, the energy, and then go with it. I know where I'm going to start. I know where I'm going to end. In the middle, it could be anywhere. Mm-hmm. I won't get that feel on a computer.
No. It's like I got called for one day ago, and we're raising money for COVID victims. And I'm like, what are we going to say? Like a fucking midget? I mean, really, truthfully. I mean, I go, it's just, nah, I get.
You think they get just, less COVID, Bob?
Yeah.
Because they're tiny.
Like, it's like fucking, you know what I mean? How much fucking money are we going to raise on fucking line? I mean, really, there's big fucking, you know, people that are doing this shit. Let them do that shit. Let's focus on getting this back to where we can work again. Not fucking trying to save the world with fucking comedians that are fucking dying for work.
Yeah, the people that watch a show to donate, fundraiser crowds, are not comedy crowds. They're there because they want to say, look what I did. We've all worked fundraiser shows. Those are not comedy crowds. They laugh at the hack guy who's doing spaghetti dinner bullshit and all that stuff. They like that guy. Or they laugh at something they've been told is funny. You put a famous person up. You want to throw out Billy Crystal out there and have him walk out and like barely be able to move and just say, you look marvelous. People would donate money. They don't give a shit because they're like just happy to see them. But if you and I, the people that follow people like us, they're struggling too. They don't have money to donate. They want to laugh. They don't want to feel like they have to give up $30 for a thing that's going to might go help, like you said, one midget who's coughing a little bit. It's like he should die anyway. He's a midget. They should be picked off. They have small lungs. They're not going to make it.
Yeah.
I've been asking a lot of comics this. Let me ask you. What do you think there's more of in the world? Real, legitimate, transgendered people or midgets?
I think there's midgets.
How many are there?
There's
a lot of them.
You had
to say one per whatever. Like, one per what? Every 200,000 people are midgets? It's not less than that. You never see a lot of midgets unless they're in one movie. And if you see one midget in your area, you keep seeing that one midget. You don't have other new midgets popping in.
No, I mean, but like in my world, there would be a lot more midgets popping up, you know?
They're
but
in like, your world because of what you're doing. So they're in that area, but there's not like, you're in a plethora of midget. But if you go outside that, there's no gaggles of them, you know?
No, I've never seen a midget gang come by and fuck up somebody and take their bike, you know?
But if you weren't looking down, you wouldn't see them, Bob.
Exactly. Maybe that's what it is. And I always wanted like a bird to grab a midget, a big bird, and just fly off with it. That would be the fun. Like, that should be, there should be birds big enough to carry a midget away.
Oh, there are. I think there's some condor. I don't know what a condor is. I didn't want to go eagle or hawk like a hack, so I went condor. But I think of a condor, I hope there's someone, some Australian, it had to be an Australian because they love midgets. Like, they love to throw them and stuff. He trains a bird to go get them. And they swoop in, and he has them stare at tiny people. And then when he comes back with a kid, he beats the bird. He's like, you stupid fucking bird. You don't get it. That's a kid. Can't you tell? Look for the pubic hair. It has to drop back off.
Yeah, I would love to see, like, the little legs kicking as the bird is, like, hitting the ground with them and then starting to get up and go. That would be fucking amazing. I would
need
to be
able. Midgets are dense. They're dense.
Yeah, they don't know what's going on.
No, they're heavy.
They are?
They're thick. You're looking at midgets. They're like fire hydrants. They're always I've never seen a thin midget. They just look smaller because they're tiny, but they're never like thin. They always have like fat asses.
And the arms. Yeah. The arms, like the wrist is fat. Even the wrist is fat.
Well, there's
no
wrist. I think it's hand then forearm. I don't think they're, that's what makes them a midget. They're missing parts, I'm guessing.
They look like turkeys with legs and arms.
Yes. But
if you put a little wing on them, that was what they would look like a bird.
And they have that thing, too, that little that gobbler on the bottom. They're weird necks. I don't get how people can watch midget porn. I don't get it. I don't get why you'd want to watch. I mean, I was talking to someone else the other day. Two midgets, gay porn, maybe just to go, what the fuck? There's two gay midgets? Like, maybe I'd watch it for that, just to see that and see how they talk. Do they still have a midget voice and a gay voice? I'd watch it. But, like... Yeah. Regular midget sex, or an adult, I shouldn't say adult, a regular person and then a midget fucking, I don't want to see that unless they're just going to wear him like a belt buckle and spin him around. Like, why would I watch that?
Yeah, I mean, like, if you're watching gay porn and with midgets, you'd be like, I can't believe I just came to that. Wow.
Yeah. I don't know if I couldn't believe it. I'd be like, I can't believe I want to do it again. It'd be the thing.
Yeah. No, but I mean, you watch anything because it's fucking whatever. If it's, you know what I mean? Like a girl getting fucked that's in a wheelchair, you'd watch it because it's wrong. You know what I mean? It's like you in your mind, it's wrong, but you have to watch it because some girl's getting fucked in a wheelchair.
Why is it wrong? She needs love too.
I know, but you know what I mean? It's like you can't fuck her during a thunderstorm. you can be risking your life, you know, like it's like
Bob, I take her out of the chair.
Oh, I wouldn't. You
just pull the dumb legs up, throw them over your shoulders and fuck her that way. Oh, okay.
I
would pick her out of the chair and just fold her over like a couch.
Nah, you see, because then I have to put her back in, you know.
Bob, you bring an opener. He takes care of that. You're the headliner. You don't deal with that. An opening act, he drives you. He puts the girl on the couch. He takes care of all that. And she can wear a shirt in the porn. It says, like, we'll have a good time or something like that. That'd be a fun shirt.
So you would dump her out. I would probably dump her out like a wheelbarrow. You know, just fucking, see? And then get her on the floor.
This is why we need to talk. It's like, I wouldn't have thought that. Yeah, that's why I have to look up to people like you that would think outside the crippled box. Got to think of those things. I'd rather watch handicap porn, I think, than midget porn, though.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's a lot of hot chicks that...
like missing a limb, I couldn't watch. But
yeah, missing a limb. There's a lot of hot chicks. If a guy is really ugly and that shit, but he's a nice guy, you can actually get a hot chick that's missing an arm and half a leg because they're born that way. But, you know, people are afraid to, like, drag them down the street, you know, as they're hopping with the one leg. But, you know what I mean? Like, you can get looks, but then you have to get missing body parts, which is, you know, you have to deal with it. You know, you're not going to get a hot chick that has all limbs. So you have to fucking say, hey, man, I'll deal with this. You know what I mean?
Listen, imagine a father sitting down with his son and having that conversation. Son,
we're
not lookers, okay? Back in my day, they didn't have Tinder. We're not what's known as swipeable. Here's the thing. Look for a girl. Don't look for a ring on her hand. See if she has a hand at all. If she doesn't, go for it. That's what we're all about. Are you good at building ramps? Because you're going to need one to go right into your bedroom. That's the kind of lady you're getting. You need ones that need assistance because they'll need you. Just make just enough money to pay for their helmet, and you got it.
Yeah, I mean, look, you probably don't have to buy her as much jewelry, you know?
And even if you do buy her jewelry, it doesn't have to be good. She can't go return it.
It's going to fall off anyway. Not a one-off.
She's gonna wheel up to the fucking return desk and go to the pawn shop. They're going to take her wheelchair. They're like, oh, that's worth more than the ring.
Yeah, when you get married, you go to her father and go, I'd like to have your daughter's hand. And he's like, that's all she's got. She's only got one.
She would also like to have her hand. she wishes she had her. I'd get down on one knee, but that would be taunting you.
The fucking ref would throw a flag. Get the fuck off.
Do you think handicapped people come with referees? Just to come like, no,
that would be fucking great. And a whistle. The whistle would just blow everything I said. Every time I said something to her. You know, can you get me a drink?
If someone had no arms, no legs, starfish, nubs, could you fuck them? But they're cute. They can't say hot. Nobody would be hot like that. But they're cute. They got all their teeth. Their face is good. They got a cute body. They're not heavy. I mean, they can't be heavy. They have no arms and legs. I mean, they still have. They don't have a belly or anything. And they're white. So it's everything you want.
I guess so. I look, I mean,
and they're into it. This isn't a forced thing. They like you a lot. They're like, Bob, I saw your show. They hung me from the balcony. I got to watch. It was great. And, someone just puts her in the green room and you thought it was a throw pillow and you turned around and it was a human. She's like, do whatever you want to me. I don't mind. Just put me back in the drawer when you're done. Would you do it?
Yeah, but I probably put her in the bathtub afterwards when she drowned.
Oh, before. If she's offering that to you, you're not her first. It's not the first time she's played penis pinata. You know what I mean? Just been hung from the ropes and just stuck with dicks. I'd probably ask the opener to fool around with her first.
I'd put her in the dishwasher first. Really? I'm a scumbag.
I don't think to make sure she's clean in this day and age.
That's true.
She can't put her own mask on. So she can't be clean.
And I don't know where her shoulders have been.
Right. 6 feet apart, I don't know what feet are. I've never had feet. I wouldn't know at all. Thank God you're not doing comedy years ago when you did the blue cheese thing. How would you do that from 6 feet away?
You know what? It would have been tough.
I mean, straw.
Like, when I look at it the way that this was happening, yeah, I use a crazy straw. Like, but, like, you know, when that was happening, and you look at today, what's going on in this world, and then what I was doing back then, I mean, this is two different worlds. You would think that was 100 years ago that some guy was eating a girl's ass on stage with blue cheese. And now today, you can't even go close to them. Otherwise, you're a fucking creep.
Yeah. Oh, everything's going to be weird. So many jokes that we make are going to be – that we don't even think about. Little dumb little quips that are now going to throw people off all of a sudden. Like, you know, just even making jokes about, like, coming out of the house. I watched Seinfeld's latest special, which I'm not going to shit on or say anything about Jerry Seinfeld. He's a goddamn legend. But he did 20 minutes on a phone. Do you think no one's joked about the phone, Jerry? Do you think maybe? Yeah, but whatever. It is what it is. But his first 10 minutes are about, hey, I'm just happy to get out of the house. It's like, that's going to be a thing you don't even say anymore.
Well, here's another one you won't say. You can't go, I went to the beach with my friends.
Right.
And then people will be like, what are you talking about?
I went to the bar the other night. No, you fucking didn't.
Yeah.
Where do you live, Wisconsin? No, you fucking didn't.
Finally a reason to live in that shithole.
Yeah. Isn't that hilarious that they become like a destination hotspot? Wisconsin. I'm going to Milwaukee. That's where the bitches and the fun are.
Well, that's what I was saying. I was like, what is going to keep people? Okay, New Jersey's opened up beaches, right? And all that stuff now. Just beaches and jet skis and fishing boats, like shit like that's going to open this week too. But say you're from New York City, which is real close to Jersey.
Right.
It's an hour and a half. You're at the shore, right? What's going to keep those disease fucks from coming into my land and fucking Corona or us up?
Yeah. It's going to be really hard to stop that. Are we going to set up borders now and say, if you're not from here, there are people that live in Jersey that have New York licenses, New York. There are people that do live one place, but have something else stating something else. What if, are they not going to be allowed in if they do live there? Like, I live in Connecticut.
Terrorists they are.
If if I came up to you and I coughed at you in your house, you could say I was a terrorist act.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Yeah.
And all the people that are dying from like regular stuff, like when Don Shula died, I saw someone post, God damn it, COVID. I'm like, he was 87. COVID didn't kill Don Shula. Those terrible years of the Dolphins did. That's what killed him.
That should have killed him way earlier. But the whole thing is that, you know, people are dying that would have died anyway. But that most of them are nursing home people. Like in Jersey, half of them are nursing home people. We're at about 10,000 here. About 5,000 have died in a nursing home. And they're not, okay, what happens when somebody's sick in a nursing home? They call the ambulance to come and get them. So they bring them out, okay? Then they bring them back. And when you bring them back, they're not trained to do anything but just keep the person alive as much as they can for the ambulance to come. You can't bring them back in when that happens. And then they're in a place where they're totally a victim to get COVID because they're in their 70s, 80s, or 90s. And then you take them out, you put them in there, one little fucking germ gets in them. But they would have died anyway with the trachs. They don't put not everybody's trained to put trachs in.
Right.
My wife is a fucking more of a she works in a proctologist kind of part of it. She puts people under and that. She was sent to New York. They didn't have masks. They didn't, if you question anything that they said, they would move you to another floor. And most nurses they know what they're doing with this, but they don't know, you know what I mean? And they go, learn it.
Right.
And you can't learn it with people's lives. And that's the whole thing.
You'd be an asshole. I mean, you definitely could, but you'd be an asshole if you're like, I'll practice on I would do is I'd walk around the floor. I would have conversations. Anyone that was a dickhead or just boring, I'd practice on them. If you're a good conversationalist, we save you. But if you're boring, we need to get rid of you anyway. So, all right, let's try this out.
Yeah, it was a mess at the beginning. Like people were, they couldn't go into the room to help people because if somebody's like falling off the bed, they couldn't go in there unless they got the right equipment to go in. And it's just crazy.
And I hate to say this, but if you're in that home though, like you're close to dead. I mean, like you.
No, but this was in New York.
No, I know what you're saying. I'm saying in convalescent homes and stuff. you're close to that. So when they start saying the numbers right away and start saying like, well, all these people, like, yeah, but at most, like in Connecticut, there was a big number in Norwalk and they were like all these people dying in Norwalk. But then you found out like it was like 70 or 80 right away, but like 55 of them were from this one home.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, that's, they're supposed to, like, I don't, as someone's grandparent, as someone's family member, I understand that, but they're supposed to. They're saying the average age of people dying of COVID is like 81. That's a higher age than the life expectancy. You know what I mean? So it's like, it sucks that people are dying. It's crazy that they're dying. And I'm not going to compare it to flus or dumb shit like that, but I think we're going overboard with the fucking numbers and craziness. Let's figure out how we can all start living again. Let's all stop arguing about how we all know this and that, whatever. Nurses shouldn't have to learn some new fucking thing or craziness. Let them do what they do. Let doctors do what they do. If you're sick, get the fuck away from me. Go on Epstein's Island. Go live there. And
go not, stay and home.
Let us stay here.
Stay home or stay at the nursing homes. They should have basically doctors and nurses come in, or if they bring them to the hospital, they stay in a certain section. You have to do everything. And then when we go back out, we do it like we do at home, like we're doing now. Let us at least, give us a chance to do what you're saying works. Oh yeah, it works at home. Not really, because, you know, I mean, how much germs is in your house? And then you start cleaning it every second. Then you got no germs. Now you go out and then all of a sudden the germs are there again. So it's like, you can't really think of any way that's going to work properly.
Our immune systems are becoming a bunch of pussies. We're getting weaker because we're protecting ourselves so much that when we do go back out, we're going to be weaker and it's more susceptible to taking on stuff. It's kind of like, you know, when you're a hardcore drinking alcoholic to the point where it's like, someone's like, you already had a 30 pack and 2 fifths of scotch. Are you okay? I'm like, oh yeah, my tolerance is about that. I'm only buzzed right now. Like,
yeah.
Our immune systems were building up that kind of thing where we were becoming that strong to like germs and certain things. Some of us can handle. I've never had a flu ever. I've never been sick. I'll guarantee when I go out now, I'll probably get a cold or something because I've been now not out there, not in the elements, covering up, staying away from people. It's going to be, and we're also going to be so hypochondriacs. We're all going to be like afraid. Now, if you do cough, you're nervous. You hear a cough, you get scared. See, you're going to go to the doctor more. Your insurance rates are going to go up. It's going to be insane.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I had to go for a kidney stone. I went to the emergency room at 3:00 on a Sunday a few weeks ago. There was nobody in there. Yeah. Nobody's going to see the doctors. Like, there's a lot of people like me waiting for surgeries. We have to wait until they let it open again, you know? And, you know, there's people with cancer that are waiting to get in. Like, it's crazy. Like, it's like, there's nothing, you know, you can't just do anything because of the fact you're waiting for the okay for it to open up. You know, if you think you have breast cancer, well, you got breast cancer because you're not going to go see a doctor right now. And you have to wait. Imagine what's going through these people's minds.
It's insane. It's you're told to rush any sign or whatever. And now it sounds like, well, too bad. Like, we can do a virtual one if you want. I've done that. I've had a virtual doctor's visit, which the doctor was sitting on her bed. I'm like, well, really? I can't tell you how I feel. I can just tell you, you can kind of guess from what I'm saying, but you need to run some tests or do something. I had to go to the emergency room too about a month ago. I had to go for I have high blood pressure, but I was really feeling bad. I have hypertension. I was like 170 over 90. It was crazy. And it was, but I got there, same thing. Nobody else was there at all. No one in the emergency room. The nurses were saying they weren't allowed to take breaks anymore or drink drinks or do whatever. If they, instead of having coffee or water, they could do an IV bag, which is insane, like taking an IV break.
Well, that's what it is. I got the IV bag, right? And then I get it off and that stuff. They gave me the stuff for pain and the IV thing. And I'm walking out. I got my jacket and they wouldn't let my wife in. I get to the car and I go, well, my arm's really wet. I take off my jacket. Blood is pouring out of me because they used a little cotton ball and a paper tape, a skinny paper tape on it. And she goes, that's not how you that's the first thing you learn is how to bandage a fucking IV thing. And it was blood pouring all over me. She had to stop it. Then they told me I had one kidney stone and I just get paranoid. So I called my doctor and she goes, well, let me check out your thing because it's rare to have it on, you know, another side later. And she looks at my thing and she goes, no, you have 3 kidney stones, not one. And I'm like, no wonder why I'm sweating at night.
Right.
I'm thinking I got the fucking COVID and fucking, I freaked out. And it's just that they are so, now you're telling me that people aren't dying there because of what happens when they're getting taken care of. You're crazy, because they sent me home bleeding and with one kidney stone, not three. So, right. You know, you understand?
Yeah, it's insane. Like, same thing. I wonder if it's, I know it's two different states, but it's almost like our nurses were the same person. They went to go take blood from me and she couldn't find a vein. She kept missing. And then she goes, she yells out, I need a manual. And I go, you don't know how to do this? She goes, no, that's what we call the device that the, I'm like, okay, maybe change the name or whatever to fuck the name, because manual doesn't sound good. But she still had to call in for backup, and then someone else had to do it. And they're like, it's almost like you don't have veins. I'm like, well, I know I have veins. So you'll find them. That's your job, not my job to know them. Sorry I didn't do heroin earlier to pop one up for you. But find the blood. Get this fucking crazy lady away from me. Why is she here if she can't do that?
That happened to me, brother. I went to give, you know, my blood test for the operation, the last one before cancer. She goes to get, and she go. I go, you done yet? And she goes, no, I missed the vein. I go, oh, really? And she goes, yeah, it moved. The vein moved, she told me. I swear to God. And now I'm starting to get sweat because she's not finding it, and I'm sweating. And all of a sudden, I fucking just about pass out. And they're like, you need water? They put smelling salt in front of me. You see what I mean? Yeah. Because of the fact that I started flipping out because she told me the vein moved. It jumped. It jumps, she tells me. And I'm like, it jumps? Are you fucking kidding me?
Veins,
and this is the people that
are there
trained.
Black kids in there doing double dutch? How the fuck does it jump? It's a vein. It doesn't move.
Dude, it's just not. You know what I mean? You think because you're with the doctor and a nurse, you're safe. You're not, you know? And to not have a family member with you in a time when you definitely need them is probably the scariest thing. And that's why people are agreeing to get trachs. If a doctor tells you this or a doctor tells you that, and you have nobody to talk to, like in the beginning, what are you going to do? You're not going to argue.
You don't even know how to argue. You don't even know what to think. You're scared, and you're just saying, yeah, and they don't know what to do either. But we've always been taught to trust what they think. And it's not their fault. This is a new fucking crazy thing. They're in a world every way. Just like our acts, sometimes we can just go into automatic pilot and do the act. We can see sitting there and thinking about grocery shopping the next day while we're saying words out loud.
Yeah.
They're doing their jobs like that. All of a sudden, they're told everything you know is different. Precautions are different. This is different. You can't do this. You can't do that. You can't make this change into that change. They don't know what to do. And then if they don't know what to do, the people underneath them don't know what to do either. You know,
it's the reaction that goes all the way down. And that's what you're sitting there with something that basically, you know, there's a chance you could have lived, you know, but it's like, you're not doing autopsies to see probably how they really died. You know, it's just paying Mark probably. And the hospitals get paid more if it's COVID then.
It's a better range if they get that one. It's like back in the slave days, if they came from a different part of Africa, you got more money. Is that a Mandingo? Yeah. They go, oh, is an Amistad one? Ooh, get them. That's better credits. So, all right, let's end it on a more fun note. You have been a guest on 8 million shows. The two I know you from the most back in the day, Howard Stern, Opie and Anthony. Just show-wise, how you know them now. What show did you enjoy being on more? Stern and its prime when you were on all the time, when Artie was there and stuff. By the way, have you heard from Artie? I know you probably can't say things. I love Artie's podcast. That new Halfway House was incredible. I've listened to every episode again. And that, I was worried. I mean, I know he had to cancel gigs because he was supposed to be in Connecticut where I live. And I heard that he had to cancel stuff. I'm hoping he's okay. But have you heard anything from Artie at all?
I've texted with him maybe 4 times since he got out. And I don't know. You know what I mean? I just don't like, you know, I'm like, hey, if
life's got to be hard for a guy that everyone's waiting to fall back off the wagon. You know what I mean? And I hate that they're doing that. He's a talented guy.
I don't know what the deal is, but look, if you can't call me, then fucking.
Yeah.
I don't have time for it. I've been through the worst with him. So fuck it. You know what I mean? It's like, I wish him the best, but you know.
He could just say, I'm good, brother. Talk to you soon, and it'd be fine. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's all I just have to be around different people now or something like that. But
whatever it is, yeah, you're right.
You know, it's cool. But anyway, I just wish him the best.
Howard Stern, Opie and Anthony in their prize. What was the show that you felt like you shined better on?
Well, I definitely shined on Howard because I was on a lot more. I wasn't really allowed to do Opie and Anthony.
Oh,
I might have been in the studio. I might have been in the studio once or twice, and the rest was all phone calls, and then they didn't want me to do that. So, I mean, like, I got to do so many different things on Howard Show. I had my own radio show on there.
Oh, the roasts were my favorite on there when you would do those. That's where I really learned about you. I was working for a Budweiser at the time, selling Budweiser. I'd listen to a Sirius XM in my car all the time, and I would hear those crazy roasts they would do everyone on the show, and you'd always come in and destroy.
No, I mean, it was like, and to have Miserable Men was great. I had my own show, and that was a show that was really powerful, and people loved it. And, but, you know, I really couldn't go. It wasn't a back and forth thing for me. Other comedians, it was, but me, you're different, I was told. You're part of us.
It did feel like you were, definitely because you did that, but it did feel like when I listened that you were part of the Stern family. I mean, when you listened, you did feel that way. I don't think that was something that you tried to do, but they made it feel like that, which I guess is a good thing then.
No, it was. It was definitely a good thing until it just got to be too much fucking bullshit. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, I just seen everything falling apart and the anxiety and fucking, you know, it was just too much of bullshit. And right. You have to walk away because it ends up hurting you mentally and it could physically because, you know, I was drinking a lot. I was getting fucked up a lot. And that's how you got on the air, was being a fucking maniac.
Yeah.
And it was time to grow up, I felt.
Yeah, they wanted you to be a degenerate in that spot because that's where they could get stuff out of you. You could just tell when they listen to. Listen, you're a talented, funny guy. You don't need to be drunk to be funny. It's just weird. They wanted more train wreck than funny.
I mean, that's something that, you know, that's what you have to make decisions where you want to stay or go. My time is ready to go on Opie and Anthony, and they put an end to that when I got banned from the building. So
yeah, that helps. But now being on Kumia and Compound and stuff, my first time on there, I had not listened. My brother is a huge fan of Kumia, always has been, and he turned me on to it. Another comic got me to be a guest one time. I didn't know what to expect because I had heard – I talked about E-Rock about this when he was on my podcast a couple weeks ago. I had heard they were basically – it's nothing but, like, conservatives holding guns, talking about Trump. And I'm like, where's the comedy? No, then I go on, and it's one of the funniest fucking shows there is, and I've loved being on it. I've watched you on it. It's a spot for us to shine. Anthony really lets you shine. I mean,
no, and it's just because it just goes and whatever happens. And if you're able to guide the ship and go off the ship and take them with you and watch the genius of them too with Dave and Anthony.
Dave is so quick. It's crazy how quick he is.
And that's what it is. It's a matter of just helping the day guide. You go, boom, then you start guiding, taking a different way. Anthony or Dave jumps in. Now it's that way. Then it comes back. Then it's all the way out there again. And the fucking 2 hours are over. And that's why when you work with people that understand radio, it's so fucking easy. It's like, you know, you don't have to. Nobody goes, what do you want to talk about? The show starts and that's right.
That's it.
That's all.
But it ruins you the next time you go on a show that isn't run that well. Because you're feeling good. Then you go on and you're like, oh, no, I got to work. Or like, an hour before when they're like, hey, send me a story about the wacky thing that happened. I'm like, what? No, I don't have
a wacky thing. I hate when there's fucking, like, I can work with two other people. After that, it's just too much. If there's fucking 5 to 7, it's like, why am I here? You know what I mean?
You're coming in. They want you to be part of their world. Hey, Billy Bob has been doing this crazy thing by pouring Gatorade on his head. Can you make fun of that? I'm like, I don't give a fuck about Billy Bob or you. Like, let's just have fun. Let's just talk about things that are in the news or what things are going on, and let me just riff and do whatever, and we'll have a good time. Some radio shows let me do that, but some radio shows really, like, I try to stop doing those now because I get nothing out of it. And, like, we're doing it to get people to follow us and get, you know, publicity and a fan base more. And I don't want someone to think that's what I am. That's not my humor. They'll come see my show and go, wait, he's way different, way edgier than he was on that stupid-ass morning show. So, yeah, because that's a stupid-ass morning show. Who would go watch that show?
That's what it is. It's when you're – okay, when you're on their show, you know it's just going to be you being you with them. You know what I mean? And that when you have all these other people with these other – you know, there's 5 people on there, and they're like I'm a guy that talks. I fucking go out and fucking talk. You're a guy that talks. I'm not there to listen to these other fucking 4 people talk while I'm fucking here when I'm going a totally different way than they are. And to me, it was like, why did I just do that?
Yeah.
I don't understand this. There's too many people. You know what I mean? I'm not used to that.
Oh, it's beautiful. Like you said, I forget who was telling me. Oh, it was Mike Fenoya, a comedian. One of the first times I went on, he had told me, he goes, the thing he had learned from someone else is when you go on Kumia, Kumia has all these notes in front of you, like himself, because those are like stories you're going to go with. But he has that just in case. You know he's enjoying the conversation if he doesn't go through the notes, because he'll trust that you're going to do it. If it comes to a lull or he needs a new step, he'll go reading it. So he told me that, got in my head. The second time I was on, he went through like five papers, and in my head, I'm like, I'm fucking failing. Oh my God.
No.
I told someone that later, and they laughed. They said, no, he wanted to get to those things. I let that one thing get in my head.
Well, that's what it is. When he gets to a story, when I'm thinking to myself, let's keep this fucking thing going, and let's keep it this way, that way, then come back, close it, and then move on to the next thing. That's when you put on good radio when you do it like that, right? You know? And that's what's so great about it. And it's like a fucking amazing. Like, I haven't even tried to get on his show because I don't feel like I can do it like how I would want to, like this. Me and you, I could talk to me and you, but I can't talk, you know, I know it would not be what I would want. So I'd rather wait until we can all sit down again together, because this is like, you know, this is, has to be a one-on-one thing, or, you know, maybe two people, but it's so much different. And just how I feel when I'm in the studio with them, it's so fucking enjoyable. And I don't want to have this. I don't want to do it online with them. But
I did do it with them once, and I was out of the concerns, but just like the normal professional is, like, they held back. Dave held back a little bit more, but you find yourself holding back a little. But the pausing was okay, but you're worried about talking over each other. It went fine, and people enjoyed the appearance. But, yeah, it did feel weird. Like, one of the best feelings I've ever had outside of comedy, even in comedy, I got to sit there one time with Anthony, Dave, and Jim Norton, and then me. Wow. And I'm like, those three – I mean, even Dave was kind of like, you know, when Jim and Anthony are together, they don't need anyone else in the world. And then for me to be in there too, in my head, I was like, well, I got to try to hang with the fucking three home run hitters, and I'm hoping to hit a double. And the fact that I did hang and they didn't try to like push me out of the way, and I was able to be quick and do whatever, I felt really good. But I was more exhausted from that than doing like an hour and a half gig. You know what I mean? Like, I was beat after that.
Well, the whole thing is, when you're working with three people that totally understand it, it's easier. It's easier to get in there and fucking just fucking be funny. You know what I mean? When you're working with shit like comedians in front of you that suck, it's harder. Right. You want people that can kill around you, because then you shine bigger. And if you can't shine bigger, then you're not right for the show. And that's the bottom line.
Oh, that in comedy, Listen, it happens many times. Someone in front of you could stink, whatever. And people are like, oh, do you want to follow someone funny? I'm like, I want everyone in front of me to destroy.
Exactly.
I want the crowd to have fun. They're not going to be tired. I'm a different human. You can watch a TV show, then change the channel, watch another fucking TV show. It's a different show. You can enjoy both things as well. I want everyone to kill. It's not fun to do well in front of someone that bombed, because half of it, the crowd's just like, well, we've got to laugh at something. They're almost giving you pity laughs. You're like, no, I want to earn your laugh. I know I can get those laughs. Exactly. But when I was sitting with those three, my only fear was, I don't want to be the human tumbleweed in the middle of three guys just crushing. And then I'm like, wah, wah. So that was my whole thing. But like, I trusted my gut and I just said whatever, and it went fine. But I've been on shows with big names, but that was one thing where I didn't even know Jim was coming. He just walked in last second. Yeah. I was like, oh, fuck.
So, no, but that's the time to shine. That's the time when, you know, you're going to be noticed by Anthony and Dave. You know what I mean? That's when you're going to get noticed by the fans, and you're going to get noticed by the show. It's not when you're by yourself. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you have to do your job, but when you can shine with people that have done this a long time and that are fucking really good at it, then they're like, hey man, this guy can handle anything.
And the cool thing is too, like, their fans are so loyal and crazy. Like, yeah, they can be ruthless motherfuckers, but we're ruthless motherfuckers. So like, when I was like, oh, someone's like, oh, he looks like, they were calling me, I think it's called Scorch or some guy that used to be on ONA. I don't know the guy's name.
I heard the name. Yeah.
Yeah. They're like, he looks like this, or he's this, he's that. And they're taking shots, but most people are so like passionate and like, hey, we like when he's on here. It's a different type of voice, whatever. And they were so supportive. When I was on with the bigger names, they're like, wow, Pat hung with those guys. It almost like gained me more followers just by doing what I was supposed to. Their audiences, make me feel good, almost as good as, like I said, I was on stage. If I can't have that feeling, it's fun to be on their show in Hot Water, which is my favorite fucking show. Yeah. The two at Berg is just brilliant. And I love Gino. Gino runs that ship. The two guys in the booth, Steve and Garrett, they're a team. That's a show I make sure I can watch every morning when I'm not working, because it's just, it makes me laugh. It reminds me of like early Stern when they're just taking chances and not giving a fuck. You know what I mean? Oh, you froze on
Like back there. 30 years.
Yeah.
I've known Gino for like 25, 30 years. I always knew he was funny, but he never, like, he'd be like, well, people want you to do it this way. And he'd be like, Bob, tell you the truth, I don't want to do it then. Right. And that's how he's always been honest like that. You know what I mean? He's like, he has a way to do what he wants to do. And that's, you know, on stage, he's not going to calm down if somebody tells him. He'd rather not do it. Aaron, I just kind of, you know, recently got to know who he was and that shit. And he is fucking brilliant. His mind is so quick. The way that he takes things and the way that they work together, it's really amazing when you really watch it and you're like, oh my God, I've never seen it going that way. You know what I mean? It's like fucking, and the way Aaron will just tease him and go, well, Gino, that's not what I meant. You know, when he did mean it. But he knows how to just take it. And then, like, the guys in the booth, like you said, they're on top of that. They're part of the show now.
They're incredibly part of the show. The Garrett is brilliant, and Steve is now just striped out. And what's cool is you're talking about people trusting each other, that Aaron and Gino are letting them do that. There's a lot of shows where people are like, oh, I don't want you getting more laughs. This is our show. And they're like, no, let Steve be the star. Let Garrett be. When I come on, I have a great time on there because I watch the show, and I get it. But they've always said they let me be me, even more so. And they're showing so many people on it. It could be hard. Even through this Zoom thing, Aaron's doing it, not in the studio. And it seems like it never changed. It's incredible.
No, it's amazing. I mean, it's like, and he's a good guy, too.
Oh,
and
that's what, one of the nicest people. He's reached out to me many times. He's really helped me out a lot of things. Both of them. Gino, it's been wonderful. Gino came on the podcast. Gino is someone I've known for a while, because if you work in tri-state area, you've worked with Gino. And same thing. I've known Gino forever, and people will be like, hey, be a little cleaner. He's like, oh no, thanks. I do me, because we're told when we first start doing comedy, what's the other comic saying? Find your voice and stick to it. Don't let people change your voice. And so he found his voice, and then people are like, well, don't be this. Like, well, no, fuck you. I found what I can do, and he shines in this role now.
I met him. I found him in Delaware years ago, and I was like, I found him and Keith Pennell, and I was like, both of you are really good. And then the other guy is like, how come you're not giving me work? I'm like, well, you're not as good as that. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like, you shouldn't ask me. There's a reason why. You know, don't make me hurt your feelings, because I'm not going to lie to you. But I was like, these guys, I'm going to take with me and make them learn, you know?
Right.
And that's what I do.
Bob, where can people – thank you for doing this. I really appreciate it, man. It's cool that on a Sunday you can jump in and do this. Thank God the world stops. We're all in timeout so we can chat. Where can people follow you, see all your stuff?
Well, on Twitter, you can follow me at Levy_Sir.
I think if you move your body out of the way, they can read all of it right there.
And then, then we're going to be on syndicateradio.tv. Nice. And then we're going to have a whole bunch of links that will be able to go to the syndicate thing. We'll probably start Monday. And the tapes will be up. We're not going to go live, I decided, because you have all this time. Why set a live time when you don't have to?
And right now, even though people are sitting at home, they've kind of built schedules in. It's going to be tough. It's better off to just give them a chance to check it out first and then make them want to see it live when it is.
Yeah, we'll do it live once in a while, but, you know, like that. And then Facebook, I have 3 Bob Levy's and the Reverend Bob Levy fan page. And Instagram, I'm Levy Sir. No, Levy Bob, underscore Bob. I post my dog a lot of times. My dogs are mostly in that. But you know.
Your Twitter is beyond enjoyable. It's one of my favorite ones to follow. Sometimes it's opinionated. Sometimes you're doing song parody. You show a different range of things all the time. I always enjoy following you.
Thank you, brother. You too. And, you know, it's like good to be back on Twitter. I started again in maybe September, the end of August. And yeah, I missed it for a year. I got thrown off. I had like 80,000 people, and it's like they took my check mark away, everything. But it doesn't matter, because I'm having more fun now. You know what I mean? It's like I get plenty of responses with 5,600 than I did with 80,000. Like, you'll see people with 120,000 and they're not getting any, because they're dead accounts. They're this, they're that. you know? So it's good to kind of restart.
No, it definitely is. So, Bob, thank you so much for doing this, man. I really appreciate it.
Hey, man, thank you. This was fun as hell, brother. And I'll see you soon, brother.
See you soon.